Welcome back to the My Pet Bird level of Outings with the Delver. Last time we learned how to pilot a fegundo around, and we established it in sort of an informal theme of eating water skippers. In this case, we actually found the nest that is producing all these water skippers, although thankfully Beethro has had enough sense to put the nest in containment, so we're not going to get overwhelmed with water skippers here. Now, last time we had a bit of a tricky serpent maze, which I think was meant to be second in line. I think we were actually supposed to do this course first. So let us get our pilot's license and actually pilot this bird around. Now, what are we actually supposed to be doing here? It appears that we don't want to be hitting any of these single-use plates, fair enough. But we also want to get our bird to get something to hit each of these. Now, I think I understand the general principle here. It's that we're going to be taking advantage of the construct's unusual preference. It kind of shares this with, I believe, goblins, but not Omplik, and Seep. In that it doesn't necessarily have vertical preference, it has major axis preference. So in particular right here, when Beethro is all the way east of it, it will tend to want to have horizontal preference rather than vertical preference because its horizontal distance is very large. So it wants to close that to get closer to Beethro. So the way we're going to take advantage of that is, I believe I have spotted the necessary technique here. It's going to be a little bit... Yeah, this is going to be a little bit tricky, though. I need to get Beethro in the right spot first, because we're going to need to time this just right. As usual. So here... let's see. Yeah, I'll want to hit it while I'm facing east, so actually I want to step here. So now I'm going to face northeast and get the bird here, and now I'm going to face east. So Beethro's going to face east and hit the orb. The fegundo will move before the construct because, in general, fegundos are fast moving. They move before almost all other monsters because they're kind of like a player thing. So the fegundo is going to move east. The construct is going to then see the fegundo as a diagonal obstacle here and then move east because it's a construct. So I think... Now here's the tricky part. We're going to need the construct to hit each of these plates because the fegundo can't, and we don't want to blow it up either. Because if we blow up the construct, we're going to be in trouble. And what does that do? Opens that, of course. Okay. So here, the last trick that we just need to understand here is that, well, sure, we can do this. But in order to do this part, we're going to turn our fegundo southeast, and our fegundo won't hit this plate. So that will safely guide the construct in between these plates and keep it from hitting either of these. And we'll get Beethro further east so he can do this part. Now, the last part... Now, this is where we're actually going to need to blow up our construct, buddy. Because there's no way we can really get him to hit this one. Alright, so that was a neat little room. I happen to, figure out that, hey, we have a construct. That's exactly why we have a construct and not, like, a roach or a spider or anything else that can move over shallow water. It's, just the right tool for the job here, as it turns out. And once again, our fegundo is well-fed. Excellent. Alright, moving right along. What else have we got? Alright, so more of a puzzle, kind of an analysis room rather than a tactical room, I suppose. Here's a force arrow that stands out. Yep, well, there's clearly something going on over there. We'll find out about that later, though. So if we hit this, probably with a fegundo, we will light this fuse and allow the briar to go in here. It will open that, and what does that do? That lets the roach in here. So eventually the... Well, we don't want that to happen. Alright, so there's a lot of strange things going on here. We have a caber, which we can use to push the fegundo around if we need to. I'm not entirely sure what's going on here, but let's just see everything go wrong first. That's an instructive thing to do. See what goes wrong. So we're going to hit that. That will light this fuse. That lets the briar out. The The roach is on this arrow. How are we going to kill the roach? So in this case, the briar connects to this, all this briar that we left behind here. It's going to grow this basically instantly, and then get over here and do that, which is going to immediately hit the powder keg. Now, keep in mind here that this here, ideally I think we want this fegundo to hit this plate at the same time that the briar hits that plate. And the reason for that is that's going to toggle this fire trap twice, which will keep it off. And it will also toggle this door twice, which will cut this fuse. So that all has to happen fairly quickly. It has to happen, in fact, let's just time the fuse here. Alright, so it would happen about here. So that has to happen pretty much as fast as possible. So we need this, we actually need this briar to get right here at a very specific time. Yeah, because if it actually gets here too slowly, then the fegundo will actually hit its switch first, and this will be too late, and I don't want that either. And we can't really slow this down either, because we can only slow it down in multiples of 5, which is gonna probably put us off sync. So how many turns do we want to wait? So that happens on this turn, and then how many turns late, like early is this? So that happens on turn 10. But we want it to happen on turn 16. So we want to delay this by exactly 6 turns somehow. Well, we can manage that. We can cut away exactly 6 squares of briar growth. Now the question here... Well, I suppose if the roach gets in here and this roach gets in here, like, I could just, Like, what's wrong with this part? Okay, well that's gonna blow up that length, but how about that? Like, will this suit our purposes? Let's see. So when do... Okay, so these force arrows never turn off then. So by blowing up the briar on that specific length, we never, the briar can never get through there, so that's obviously bad. Same here. So we want to not blow up that segment. So I think that's what the... That might be what the decoy with the caver is for. Yeah, we can definitely fix that. The question is, where are we going to put that? Because the decoy with the caver can block fegundo explosions, but there's only so many places we can actually put it. Because here's what I'm thinking. We do want 6, of course. We can get 5 fairly easily. Because I believe... Well, okay, I mean, we're gonna have to blow this segment up. I think we want to keep this segment of briar, and we also want to keep the briar connected across the force arrow like that. So we can get 4 fairly easily here. It's just a matter of, I think the last thing we want to do... Okay, I think I see it now. I think that's what this southern segment is for. We could have added extra segments on here however we like, but I believe what we need to do is like this. I guess it's okay if Beethro keeps his caver. So here's how it's going to be. We're going to blow up 2 here, and we're also going to blow up 2 out here, and the last 2 are going to come from here. I was wondering initially how I was going to place the decoy over the west or east segments, but then I remembered that the center segment was still accessible by foot, even if I couldn't place anything directly there. Alright, so that's going to get us our last 2, and I believe that should make this all line up. Let's see. So now we can kill this roach, because the roach actually had somewhere safe to go. He could actually escape from his force arrow into empty space here, and get stabbed. Briar will go across this force arrow. Briar will go across that force arrow. And is our timing right? That should blow up this turn. That should also land on there that turn. And that cuts our fuse. Brilliant. And now we can feed our fegundo. There's just nothing in life better than seeing a fegundo that's just happily eating a good meal. Alright, so now we can push around our fegundo because our fegundo is, well-trained. He's well-trained to put up with this kind of thing. So let's see, I believe we have a portable obstacle here, is what we're asking for. Yes. Yeah, why don't we do something like this? Alright, let me elaborate on this a little bit. The reason that this works is twofold. I don't believe movement order actually matters here, because the movement order we've been supplied with is one where all the roaches just kind of move in order and they all just keep together. But I believe that even if they were in a different order, that wouldn't change matters, because this roach would move first and then there would just be like a gap in here behind these. So when we get to this part, this roach would be here and these roaches would be just even further behind. So they would still be able to just fall in nicely into formation here and still get fried on this 4-0. Alright, now what's being asked for here? Probably something similar. Sure. Okay. Well, I can still get my sword back, or my stick back, like so. And then this last one should... Well, here's the hard part. Yeah, how are we going to line this one up? It would seem like we actually might want to do this one later. Well, here's another idea. This one will actually give us access to the power token, so why don't we just block those ones off? Yeah, I'd like to see you try and get to me now, suckers. Alright, well, that was a nice little puzzle. Chomp. Yeah, so far these actually seem like pretty jaunty rooms. I think the serpent room was the exception, and I think that was only because I was making it hard on myself with the challenge. That one... Even this one would have been easier if I just used the disarm token and had freedom of movement, so I think that one was just an unusual standout in difficulty. So let's move right along. What else have we got? Alright, we can get gel babies across the shallow water. We've got a stalwart here who's a bit of a pack rat. That's not unusual, though. We can't even get into the southern area, so let's see. What have we got? That is just shallow water. Okay, shallow water. That's helpful. So we got floor spikes. What are those for? Is there any way to set off the fuse? Yes, the fegundo could do it, but we don't want that to happen because... Yeah, that is a room clear gate open, so definitely don't want that. I mean, we could use the fegundo. We don't want to get the fegundo trapped because obviously it has to eat its lunch. So yeah, it seems like we don't want any explosions to happen around the periphery. So this whole setup is a setup for either a puff or the stalwart to kill the gel mother with. That is what I'm seeing here. Now, how's that going to happen? So that is a fluff vent. Hopefully... Alright, so question is, would the... Yes, so the fegundo would die if it pilots into a puff. It would appear that the idea is to block the gel baby somehow so that the puff can still get to it. And that's not too hard to do with, well, okay, it normally wouldn't be too hard to do with shallow water, but this stalwart right here is going to make that a little bit harder. So I think there's two things going on here. I don't think there's any possible way to get the puff to kill the gel mother. I think they just don't move onto gel like that. So I think we need to build a land bridge full of ice for the stalwart to just walk across and then just casually stab the gel mother. I think he can take care of the gel babies after that, too, but the fegundo can mop up after that as well. Or the, floor spikes. So really, just the question is, how do we stop the, gel baby in place? Because shallow water alone is not gonna do it. However, the fegundo will stay in place after, if we're waiting here. So that actually would work, I believe. Like, for instance, we could do something like this. Well, we want it one square further up. And then Puffs... Oh, Puffs are just gonna go for the water skipper, of course. Alright, so in that case... I mean, that's what these hot tiles are for. We've seen them in other rooms, but this is the first room where they actually come into play, really. So I think instead what we need to do is not worry about the first few gel babies. All we really need to do is use the fegundo to distract the first few puffs. We need them to go all the way across the arena so they're not so close to the water skipper. I believe I've got all the parts in place. I think I've got the puzzle pieces all there. I just have to put them together. Alright, so that should be pretty good. Sure, we can do that one. Alright, so we'll just have to get another one then. And repeat. There's probably a more efficient way to do this, but I'm just gonna do this one at a time just to keep things simple. I'll leave the actual optimization to the people who come after me, the optimizers. And by which I mean, like, people who have already solved the hole at least a couple times and are only then worried about getting the solutions as efficient as possible. Alright, so I think next up, we need to put it here. Well, here will do. Oh, and by the way, this seems like one more thing I can point out here. Puffs will always go for the Pythagorean theorem-based closest one. So it's like, even though these are the same Chebyshev distance away, this one is the fewest number of moves away. Like, it's still like a straight line distance closest, so it goes for the Gel Baby instead of the Fegundo in this position, no matter how long I wait here. Just worth pointing out, that comes in handy in a lot of different puff levels when you're trying to distract it with certain targets. But that's pretty general enemy targeting behavior, actually. So yeah, just a matter of repeating what we did, and we should be here. Alright, that's actually a little bit too close. Let's just use this one. Alright, so now, obviously, we don't want this to happen, so I'm going to break the tie myself by moving the Fegundo out of the way just at the right time. Now, I believe this will move first. No, it won't. So that's actually a little bit of a problem there, that one. Yeah, no way around that, actually. So we're going to need to make sure the puff stays down here. I can just line this up perfectly the first time, I'm sure. Alright, so on that move, that happens, and then now it should be attracted to the gel baby. Yes, there we go. Alright, Fegundo has done its job, so now we can let our stalwart buddy out. That is going to destroy this so that we don't get any more puffs, which is fine. Alright, Stalwart has done an excellent job, and I believe we're all set. And now we can finally feed our Fegundo. Excellent. Yeah, if there's one thing that we've seen here, it's that you need to delay gratification. You need to make sure that your Fegundo can actually do its tricks before you actually feed it. Otherwise, it's going to go directly for the food, and then it won't learn a thing. And, okay, nothing else here. Alright, it appears that we have adequately trained our bird. Now, have we done all of our household chores? I think we have. We have cleaned up our tool shed. We have painted some excellent pictures. We have acted in the theater. We got out and met some other people. We got some fresh air. We sampled some fine wines. And finally, we actually fed our pet bird and taught it some new tricks. So I think that actually conquers the main hold. I think we're all done. At least with the required content. Well, there's no way we can just leave it at that, of course. So let's see, there is a secret in Pet Bird, of course. There was the matter of this secret passage, which I think I already found. I think it was, like, right there. Sure. So there's that. There is a secret in Toolshed of the Trade, which we can go back for. Secret in Blank Canvas, which I just didn't find. And there's another secret in Roleplay. Interesting. And we did clean up Split Personalities. So I believe that means there is exactly one secret left in each of the levels, which will be a nice review. So it only makes sense to go in order. I already know where this secret is, so let us go ahead and get right into it. So it always makes sense to just start with what you already know. And in this case, I happen to already know that there is a secret passage here, which is the way back. Alright, should have guessed, but I thought it was worth a check. So what this is actually telling me is that there is a sneaky way to get into probably either twice south, once west, or twice south, twice west. Those seem to be the appropriate places to go. Now, was there anything secret in this room? Exit rooms are usually a good place to hide something, but not this time, it would appear. Just not this time. Right, I already got that challenge. So let's just do a little bit more poking around. Is there anywhere else we can go? Well, for example, we could, not blow that up. Is anything sneaky hiding in here? Could be. I mean, this would be a nice place to hide a secret, if I do say so myself, but, I'm not seeing anything right now. Because there's no way to deactivate those force arrows. And this is sealed off because of the room clear gate, so I think that's just meant to tell us, hey, there is nothing hiding, like, behind these force arrows or anything. And I don't see any cracked walls here anyway, so I think that's all the investigative work we can do here. So we're just going to feed our fegundo some vegetables, and we'll move on. Is there anything down here? Probably not. Not as far as I can tell. I mean, this would be a fine place to hide a secret wall. It wouldn't affect the solution. Yeah, but there's just nothing here. That's all. And there's no other way for Beethro to go. So maybe this is one of those sneaky cases where the secret wall is, like, actually to the north. And then you just kind of have to wind around the rest of the level. Like, that would be a sneaky place to hide a secret, is right near the entrance, but that doesn't seem to be it either. I mean, occasionally hunting for secret walls can be a fun activity. There are some good sneaky places to hide a secret, like some balcony or some bookshelf area or some NPC area where you feel like, well, maybe there's a way to get there. Or, you know, there's a hole on the map that you have to explore. I mean, sometimes you just really feel like there's something missing from your map, and you really want to explore or figure out some way to get in there. Or maybe it involves some, like, parody or some yellow door mess that you have to work out, and then maybe there's some sneaky way to get Beethro over to an area where you didn't think he could go. Like, those are the best kinds of secrets, is somewhere where you really feel like you've explored successfully. And there was a whole contest about that, just, figuring out good ways to hide secrets. Most people actually went for the puzzle hiding a secret, which is fine. I've done that myself a few times. But it really, you know, gives away that there is a secret there. I mean, it's hard to find a really good organic way to hide a secret, which I guess is kind of what I'm talking about here. There does not seem to be anything in particular going on here. I mean, I guess I can say hi to the stalwart. Hello there, stalwart. You know where the secret room is in this level? Do ya? No, it would appear not. You might want to get out of here. There's like a bunch of, gas here. Which might be a bit of a problem, sir. Sir, are you gonna do anything about this? I'm telling you, it's just so hard to find good hired help these days. But, doesn't seem to be any, secret in here. Huh. Well, that's probably enough for now. I'll probably spot that later, but we'll just leave it for that. Alright, so we did solve split personality, so perhaps, well, maybe we should do a blank canvas. This was the very first one we did, so maybe this should be where we go looking for a secret next. Secret walls can be a little bit hard to spot in this room style, especially in Iceworks, they're very hard to spot. But in this case, I'm assuming it's probably just going to be tucked away in the corner somewhere. We already did this room, which was the secret variant of a required room. Or no, it wasn't secret at all. It was just harder. A variation on a theme, so to say. But there's only a limited number of places you can really hide a secret. There's many ways of doing it. I'm just mostly talking about the general case of using a secret wall to hide a secret passage to an adjacent room. There are certain constraints on that. Not least of which is just, which rooms can you put it in, exterior, routes to the outside, things like that. But, I mean, you can use stairs from other levels, you can use scripted exits, you can do all kinds of things. Yeah, this was the only level with NPCs in it. Like, I was expecting that to be kind of more of a theme, like, Beethro is going out into the world and doing activities that other people are also engaged in, but that just kind of didn't go anywhere. It just, I just saw it in this level, and then that just kind of dried up afterwards. It's unusual, but, it's okay. I mean, take it from me, I've done this before. It takes a lot of work to really do a lot of writing and really figure out where everybody is supposed to be. Yeah, so I guess I just don't really know what's going on here. There might be some secret as far as crafting a particular picture, like a portal to a new world, where you can just really figure out what's going on, but yeah, I don't even really know what I'm doing here. There's no reason for this. But, you know, sometimes it's just nice to feel like you've really cleaned up something. Another thing to experiment with is doubles. Those are usually pretty helpful for getting into new places. Like, I mean, well, this one's trapped. I'm on Forcer, should have guessed. But yeah, I'm not seeing anything suspicious in this room either. This would be a prime place to do it because there's three different room edges you could go into. But sometimes you just need to revisit your past and really figure out, you know, is there something else I could do? Oh, I didn't really finish my thought earlier. When I was talking about constraints, like, obviously, like, here would be a terrible place to put a secret because that would just interfere with the mechanism that this hallway is setting up. So I could be pretty sure there's not a secret in here, for example. Oh, I think this might be it. No, that's not a, this ain't a secret down here. That's just smudgy. That's what that is. Alright, well, I think I'm just wandering around in circles here. Well, maybe there's one other thing. Like, did this have anything suspicious going on with it? Not really. It's just there. Alright. Well, I think I'm done here. I'll just, I might explore this more off-camera in my own time. I thought, like, these little niches up here might be a sneaky place to hide a secret room, but that does not seem to be the case either. So I think I'm just gonna leave this one for later. I'll find the, secret entrance some other time, but I think I have a lead in the roleplay level. I think I have an idea for where that secret might be, at the very least. So we'll just leave that one alone till later. Yeah, here we go. Roleplay. Yeah, so the thought just occurred to me. Well, okay, there's nothing sneaky going on in here, but I thought I might just double check. The first secret that we found in this level, Ended up actually being up here. It was pretty easily telegraphed by this green door that didn't do anything. A subtler hint was this tunnel that didn't actually play a role in the solution, but could have been used as a one-way passage back from this upper area, which is another clue that you can use when you're searching for secrets, is that maybe you need a return passage back from some other area where you can't really get back from easily. And that can be a hint to use like a clone or a mimic or some other way of getting to an area that you can't get back from easily. So that's how we ended up in here, and that's how we ended up using this passage to go here and then through this tunnel, which was a way to get back. But the green door really gave it away. So here's what I'm thinking. We never found a way to... These soldier passages are also usually good ways of hiding secret rooms, because they're pre-existing ways of going to another room. You aren't always able to get at them, but sometimes there's a sneaky way that you can kind of get in them anyway and then see where the soldiers came from. So I'm going to poke around in there a little bit and see if that yields any fruit. And hopefully it does. That would be nice. Oh yeah, and there is the matter of this room. I only solved it one way. I believe, let's see here. I think it was... Yeah, I think I used the roach to kill it. So I think I got this challenge because I used roaches instead of puffs. So some other time later, if I really need filler for an episode or something, I might use puffs to kill the serpent instead of a roach. That I'll leave that until later, though, because it's not even a secret room. It's kind of a challenge. So it isn't like blocking off a master wall or anything. Now, one other interesting aspect of this is I can't actually become a stalwart anymore because there's no Oomplik here. And there's no seating beacon to reset the room with. Well, here's a secret wall. Okay, so actually, I can be a stalwart if I want to. Wait, what? Oh, I see. I'm hitting this orb manually. That's right. Every single time I was a golem and I couldn't hit it at all, and the Oomplik was the one that got rid of this, but this is the first time I'm actually hitting it with my sword. There we go. Now we're getting somewhere. So then I guess the question is, do we want to be a golem or a stalwart in the next room? Well, we just hit a checkpoint, so I guess we can find out ourselves. Or maybe the room will make the decision for us. No, we can be in here as a golem. Clear the room while wearing a citizen costume. Well, let's just take a look and see what's going on here. Here's a changing room to be a seat, which, we've seen ways in which that can really play out. That's a very unusual player role. We would probably want to hit a power token or something in order to be able to break these orbs. I don't see any other way that's going to happen. And then we probably want our guards' help here to kill these seep. That's the only way I see that happening. Alright. Yeah, definitely a lot of very unusual things happening here. Here's a stick, which is probably some sneaky way to get over here or something. Is that the citizen costume we're talking about? Yeah, I don't know. Lots of strange things happening here. So would being a stalwart help us here? It would help us kill these seep at the very least, which would probably help. So I might as well do that. I don't think there's any reason not to do that. Alright, so let us just see to what extent that will help. Alright, so that lets us kill all that for free, essentially. We've broken stealth doing that, but we'll see to what extent that matters. So now we are a seep, now we can move around in the walls, which is helpful. We have broken stealth, so all these monsters notice us, but that's honestly kind of what we wanted to happen anyway. Alright, so that's how it gets out, and it can stab us, that's obviously an issue. So I'll probably want to lead it around the long way. Alright, so now we can be a power token person. We can be powerful. So does that mean we can light a fuse? Maybe it does. Yeah, so that guard has our number. He knows how to stab Seep. Alright, so we can sneak around him like that. Not like that especially helps, though. There's no obvious way to become anybody else. We can do stuff like this, though. So we probably just want to do this. I can't see how having extra Seep is going to help us with this bottom part here. Alright, I think having a wall like this will help us with getting rid of these Seep. That seems to be the case. But yeah, I don't see any other way of breaking that, well, okay, there's a way to break that wall. Alright, well, that's obviously an issue. Okay, so I think I see what's going on here. We don't want the guard to break straight through that. We want him to instead, make a diagonal passageway like this. There we go. So now the guard can get through, but also we can get through. And for some reason, Seep can push platforms, because that was talked about during the entryway. Now, I think the sneaky part of this is, I think to get the challenge, we need the mimic to kill a Seep after we're done here. I think that's the trick. So in order to even make that happen, we'd have to keep a Seep in this area alive, I think. Because there is not a lot of obvious places to actually get a Seep away from us. We could do this part last. There's no reason not to, honestly. So, alright. That's worth a shot. We know everything else we need to do with this room, so might as well go with it. Alright, so how are we going to kill most of these, but leave the rest alive? Well, if we can actually just run away from the rest, then that's okay. Like, our goal is to just get out of here. So we can kill these the same way we did all the other time. But I want to set up, like, a little cup mechanism to store the last Seep in, I think. Because if we can do this and, like, keep some in here, then we can run around the other way. Yeah, so now we can kill some on the west wall, and now we should be able to make a run for it out here. Now the question is, how are we going to keep one last Seep alive? Which I think we might be able to do just with the stick. The stick might be enough here. Like, we can do something like this. Yeah, so we can keep that Seep out of our hair for a little while. You know, our non-existent Seep ghost hair. Yeah, right. So we're going to use an obstacle again. This stick is going to be the obstacle. So we're going to go west to make the Seep think that we're further to our west than it is to our north. So it'll go over here. And that should get us an advantageous angle on it now. Yeah, which will give us just enough time to get out of its grasp like so. So now we're a citizen, and now we can kill the last seep while we're a citizen. Ta-da! Just excellent. Alright, so that was probably enough for now. I guess next time, I'm gonna have to do a little bit of searching off-camera to find some of these other secret rooms, because they are clearly hiding from me. In the manner that secret rooms are wont to do. But, you know, sometimes they're not necessarily quite that secret. So next time, I guess I'll just show up wherever a secret room will happen to be.